Something looks strange about the back end here. It doesn't look right. I just broke it. Hey, everybody. Back when my wife was teaching herself how to paint, this was one of her early projects. She just took a cardboard shoebox and painted it. And she was pretty proud of this box back then. And she even put her name. She signed it. I have this little piece of green tape covering her name. But these drops of water. Well, she did a really good job on it. And as time went by, she got better and better. Now I have, you know, several boxes, you know, with flowers and stuff on them. Flowers were kind of her main thing. She loved to grow flowers, and she loved to paint flowers. Now, these flowers are in quite the contrast to this wonderful piece of art. This is one of my grandchildren made this for me. Now I classify this piece of art on the same level as this piece of art for different reasons. And sure you can understand that. Yes, I know you're dying to know what's inside of this box. The first item . This is something that I ordered. It's a pair of scissors. Yeah, scissors. Back when My wife and I were married many, many decades. And during all of those decades, she was the one that wrapped the Christmas gifts. Now, for the past 3 or 4 Christmases, it was mainly me wrapping the Christmas gifts because, you know, she got to where she could not do it. Well, anyway, it was always kind of frustrating wrapping the gifts because I like, you know, we like to wrap the presents in, you know, wrapping paper. You know, some people like to, you know, put gifts in gift bags and put some tissue and stuff like that in the bag, and that's all fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But my preference was always wrapping gifts with wrapping paper. And when you use scissors to, you know, you go along. Let's see, I think I've got some over here. Use scissors, you know, to go along the paper, slicing it so that you don't have to do that all the way down a 30-inch piece of paper. You just, you know, if you got good scissors, you can just push the scissors through and slice the paper. Well, I don't have good scissors. And I'm hoping these are good scissors. So, in a future video, that's if you want to see it, you know. If you want to see me open these scissors and try them out on some wrapping paper and maybe cut some other stuff, you know, wrapping paper, felt, newspaper, fingers, whatever. Just let me know if you want to see that. And I'll save this and do it in a video. These are supposed to be some really good scissors. We'll find out. We'll do a review. Now back to these little cars. I don't store the cars in a box like this. I just use the box to transport these cars to the room that I'm in. Now, these are called slot cars. The scale is 1/32. 1/32 is the scale. And they're called slot cars because the track has a slot in it. In the bottom of the car has this little doohickey here. It's called a flag. And it goes in a slot. Like that. The silver things that you see, they're metal. And these are what, they pick up the electricity from the track. The electricity runs through these metal rails. The track is plastic. And the rails are metal. So these pieces of metal here are called the braids. Braids. Now we control the cars with a hand controller. It has a trigger on it. The more you squeeze the trigger, the more electricity goes to the track, and the faster the car goes. Now, I do what is called slot car club racing. It's basically a bunch of old men playing with toy cars. We get together at a track and we just enjoy the camaraderie and the toy cars. This is a 1970 Camaro. It's prototypical. It looks like a real car that used to race in a series called Trans Am. Trans America. It's road racing. This is a Lamborghini. It's a Colorado. Yeah, Colorado. Here's a 1970 Plymouth Roadrunner. It says 426 CI on the hood. And CI means cubic inches. So the displacement of the V8 engine in this car would be 426 cubic inches. Typically, everything else being equal, the larger the engine, the more displacement, the more horsepower. That's with everything else being equal. Here's a mid-80s NASCAR. It's a Chevrolet Monte Carlo. I think it's about an 85 model. It's got this, maybe you can see it. Let me move some stuff. It's got this big back glass. The cars that you saw running around on the street back then typically did not have that back glass. They kind of had a kind of a flat glass in the back of it. But they released a certain number of cars to the public. I think you could get that glass. I don't recall. But this glass changed the shape of the body, actually. And that made it faster on the NASCAR racetracks than the cars, than the same car without that glass. Did that make any sense? Now, what I need to do in this video is work on these cars. They have problems. This car, when we're racing this class of a car, doesn't handle very well. Now, that's because the new rules say that I can use two magnets in the car. And the magnets help stick the car to the track. Do you remember the metal rails that I was showing you that the electricity goes through? Well, because they're metal, the cars have magnets in them. And that helps keep the car on the track. Right now, this car has one magnet, and I can slide it, I can push it, and adjust the location of the magnet. I'm going to zoom in just a little bit. Reset the focus. Now this car is missing the front bumper. And maybe that's about all. Some of you might notice that there's no headlights right here. That's because they took them out and they wanted to use these holes as air inlets so that they could route air to certain parts of the car. I think what I'm going to do put a mat down here. That'll help with some of the harsher noises. Now I'm gonna add a magnet to this car. And there's a spot right here that allows me to put a magnet here. It doesn't have one right now because the rules did say that we could not have a magnet here. But the rules have changed. Now we can. We can have one here, and we can have one here. So the question is, do I have a magnet? And digging through the parts box, I'm pretty sure there's a magnet in here. Now this box is just an old cigar box. Some Padron cigars came in it. Those were good cigars. 1964 anniversary series. Now, the cigars have all been smoked up. And now the box serves as just a place for parts. Yeah, there's all sorts of parts. Because slot car racing can be kind of physical on the car. There's crashes, and sometimes they leave the track and fall a few feet to the floor and they break. These are all parts. These parts have come off cars. These are some spoilers. From various types of cars. Here's the nose off a Formula One car. Here's the rear cap off of a I forget the type of car. Someday I'll put all these parts back on. Probably at the time that I decide to get rid of all this stuff. Right now I'm still enjoying slot racing. I went for four. I spent years slot racing, but for the last 4 years, I went for 4 years without doing it because of COVID. And even after COVID kind of let up, I still couldn't go because at that point things were kind of, my wife needed me, so I had to give up slot car racing. But I've started going back, and I enjoy it, and it gets me out of the house, and that's a good thing right now. So I'm having a blast when I'm at the track. Now here's a bunch of magnets. They're all kind of stuck together. Along with some other pieces like grills. Another grill. Another grill. Now this little magnet looks like the one I'm gonna need. The magnets come in different size and shapes. Small rectangles and larger rectangles. I see some little round magnets. I see some screws. I need to get these screws out of here. I have a box to keep screws in. I think I got them all. Oh, the magnet. Now, I gotta have the magnet. A lot of dusty, dirty stuff on it. Maybe we can get that off. Piece of tape. Maybe that'll, we push the magnet against that. Maybe we can get some dirt off of it. A little bit, not a whole lot though. I have a wire brush. I wonder if that would help. I think that did okay. Now there's another piece that I need from the parts box. We need the magnet retainer. Here's one. Here's another. They appear to be, I was going to say they appear to be identical, but one looks like it's thicker than the other. My dial calipers are still they're still not around, so I can't measure them, but I can tell by looking at them. One's a little bit thicker. There's now the magnet should go right. And take the thinnest one. should fit right inside of here. And it does. And then, so there's the magnet. I'll flip it over. Then we'll put this right in the slot. Now I need some little tiny screws. We'll try some of these that we found in the box. Those new scissors probably would have been much better than the ones I just used. Let's see if this one is going to fit. A small screwdriver. Yeah. Let's get another one just like that one. How do you like this little tray? Look at the color. Is that something or what? That's probably... Most of you know that my favorite color is green. It's probably my favorite shade of green right there. Kind of an emerald. It's beautiful. So let's take this teeny tiny screw. Make sure we're in focus here. This teeny tiny screw. Put it right there. Use a screwdriver. That's good. Now, we're finished with this car. I'm going to bring that piece of track over here. Just checking the force that it takes to pick it up. Yeah, that's gonna be so much better. Now I'm gonna be much more competitive in this particular class of late 60s, early 70s NASCAR. I should take the time to true those wheels, but I'll have to do that some other time. Now on this Lamborghini. It's got someone else's initials on it because I purchased this car used. So that's from the previous owner. But there's not a magnet on this car. A little bit. Let's check the focus. Because you see these holes. If there was a magnet there, you would see the silver color. Because it's a bar magnet goes in this car. And it does not seem to have a magnet. So. That's a slick, that's a beautiful car. Just take some screws out. There's one. In their own little separate dish. You know, it's been a while since I've made a video. I need to do better. I do. Okay, this is what it looks like underneath the body. You have an electric motor and the wires end up going all the way to the braids. Remember the braids? That's a nice yellow. Not bad. go back to the parts box. Pretty strong magnets, but we're just going to take this one. I think I'll keep the magnets out of the box, at least for now. Put them over here. Yeah, slot car racing, the popularity peaked in the probably around 1967, 1968. So us old guys were young guys back then. Kids, basically. Of course, there wasn't any cell phones or computers or anything like that. So these days, you know, slot car racing, it's kind of a niche. It's not that popular for different reasons. Number one, it can be expensive if your racing hobby turns into a collecting hobby also. Adjust the focus. And we're going to put this magnet right here. There's just a little depression in the plastic chassis to hold the magnet. There's a couple of clips to hold the magnet in place. Put it. Oops, it's trying to stick itself to the metal can, the housing of the motor. That could be kind of tricky. Putting a magnet in because you have to flex the chassis just a little bit. There. It's in place. The clips up here to have a good grip on it. If you turn it upside down, now you can tell that there's a magnet in there. Yeah. So we're done with this car. really, really nice looking car. And it's stuck to the track pretty well. I think it's going to do pretty good at the track. Now for the 70 Camaro. This car races in a class where magnets are not allowed. But adding weight is allowed. So we're going to put a little bit of extra weight inside the car. That extra weight will help give the car traction. Mention, you know, that we're just a bunch of old guys playing with toy cars. But we love it when somebody younger shows an interest, because you know, we're all gonna die out. So it would be nice to see a younger bunch taking up the mantle. Boy, there is some dirt. Some dirt and gunk. I don't know if you can see that or not. Someone asked me in a comment about this little light. There's nothing to it, really. It's just, well, it's a pen on one end and a flashlight on another. You activate the flashlight just by pushing it down. So if you want to use it as a pen, put the cap over the flashlight and vice versa. So, for weight, that's supposed to be glued down right here. This car is from a previous owner also. we have different options on what to use for the weight. I was just going to take a piece of tape and tape the weight into it. But after seeing all of the dirt, kind of an oily surface, I don't know if the tape will actually hold. I might be better off machining pieces of steel that are the same size as the bar magnets, and then putting them where the magnets would typically go. That might be a better idea, because quite frankly, I had just planned on using a coin from this little treasure chest. This is generally just my little collection of, 50-cent pieces. Maybe we should see how many I have. I'm just gonna dump them out. It could be noisy. Hopefully not. Here's a bicentennial Kennedy 50-cent piece. Seventy-four. Here's another bicentennial. You know they're bicentennial because they say 1776 to 1976. Oh, here's another. I'm gonna scratch my cheek. Here's another bicentennial. Seventy-one, seventy-one, seventy-three, eighty-four, eighty-four. 92, 74, it's another bicentennial, 92, 72, 71. 92. I guess that's all of them. How many do I have? Let's see. One. I'm gonna count them two at a time. That means, you know, dollar. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, 12.50. $12.50. In 50-cent pieces. Looks like I have a couple of silver dollars here also. $72 and $71. And here's some dollar coins right here. That's a parking token. So there's $4 here. Quarters. And the quarters, they're not very old. I'm not even sure why. Here's a bicentennial quarter. I'm not even sure why they're in this little box, but they are. And they all have copper. They're not old enough to be silver. What is this? Liberty, 1979. That's a $1 coin. This is a Susan B. Anthony. Yeah, forgot all about that. One, two, three, $4.50 and quarters. Dimes. Kind of got sidetracked off the slot cars. $0.60 in dimes. So what do we see? 12.50 on the 50-cent pieces. And 4.50. On the quarters. Okay, so that's about $17. 18, 19 for these dollar pieces. Okay. That's 23. This is B&D. 24. Okay. So there's roughly $25 in change. Thought maybe I would just take a 50-cent piece and put it right here. It kind of seems like the right size. I think the dollar would be too big. It's why don't I take the newest 50 cent piece? Didn't we see a 92? And here it is, right here, 92. 92. Why don't we just plan on using that? Then we just have to tape it in. We try to get the last little bit of oil. I don't see why I just can't go all the way around it. Oh, wait a second. There's some screw holes. If I do that, I'll no longer have access to this, to that. When those screws go into the bottom of the interior. But we just won't put them in then. I think we can get by without those screws. It's just a temporary thing, you know. Coin seems like it's in there pretty good. Car's heavier. That's exactly what I was looking to do. You know what? I didn't think that through very well. Because now the coin is, it's too tall. It interferes with the bottom of the interior. Okay. Coin comes out. So much for that. I don't really have any other ideas on that. There's just no room. You know, I could probably put begin with, I can't really put anything here. I don't know if a nickel would even make a difference. Boy, it fits in there nice. And being a magnetless car, the problem it has is trying to get traction. It spins the wheels. So, yeah, maybe just putting a nickel right here will solve the problem. It fit in there so snugly. I don't even think we have to do anything except press it in. It's a 1996 nickel. It's not valuable in any way. Now, if I get into a wreck, will the nickel dislodge? We'll find out. Let's put it back together. Yeah, maybe that's all we need to do. All the screws in it. Something looks strange about the back end here. It doesn't look right. I just broke it. These things can be flimsy. Let's check. I think the nickel might be causing that problem. No. Or is it? It's hard to say. let's just let the nickel be loose instead of wedging it. Just let it be loose. Actually, I don't think that's going to make any kind of difference. This might be just a... This just might be folly. Yeah, folly. Definitely not fitting the way it should. Better. That's better. Yeah, I know I cracked it. It's okay though. Do you know why it's okay? Because it's just a thing. It's a piece of plastic. But I do like to take care of my stuff. I really do. But as I explained earlier in this video, these little cars get broken just using them. So you cannot let yourself get emotionally attached. It doesn't mean that I don't care that I broke it. I mean, I wished I had not cracked that piece of plastic. I wished I hadn't. But I did. But the damage is done. So I'm not going to beat myself up over it. I just learn to be more careful next time. Because you know what? There will be a next time. So when you make a mistake, be gentle on yourself and learn from your mistake. You need to practice that your entire life. No matter what the mistake was. Yes, I understand that some, you know, with mistakes come consequences. The consequence of breaking a little piece of plastic on this car is a very, what's the word I'm looking for? Doesn't mean much, okay? There's a word for that, I can't think of it right now. Inconsequential, I guess. But in life, depending on what mistake you make, there could be huge, huge consequences. So try not to be, you know, try not to be careless in, you know, working on a toy car is one thing. But making mistakes in other areas of your life, whether they're at your job or with your relationships, don't make those mistakes. I can't be very specific in what I'm talking about, but here's a mistake I saw just today. You know, large pickup trucks, you know, especially modified, lifted real high. You know, it's something people like, especially some of the younger people. I know I did. Back when I was, you know, 20. I saw a lady struggling to climb up into one of those today. And the man, well, he was already behind the wheel. He'd already gotten in. And I thought to myself, why aren't you over there? You know, seeing if she would like you to help her up into the truck somehow. I don't know, I've got old-fashioned views on that kind of thing, I guess. I was married for many decades. And I always held the door open for my wife. Not because I had to, not because she said I had to, not because she needed help. Obviously she did not. Well, she kind of did, you know, toward the end, but all those years prior to that, you know, it's just something I did. And it translated over, because as far as I know, my son is taking up that. He's always done that for his wife. And I don't know how people feel about that in this day and age. You know, I'm totally okay with it. I think most women, if their husbands are doing that for them or their boyfriends, I think they appreciate it. It's just a gesture. It's all it is. Now this car rattles. We'll just see how it does come race night. In this car. This video is pretty long right now, so I'm not going to do anything on camera. But this car seems kind of top-heavy. It seems like it can roll over pretty easy. So I might take it apart. See if there's something I can do to help that. So anyway, I didn't really know this video was going to end up being as long as it turned into. Somehow we got into counting money. We played with some toy cars. We looked at some beautiful works of art. And we just kind of chilled out. That can be a good thing. These coins have a nice sound. Maybe I should just do a video of nothing but coin sounds. But anyway, it is 7:40 p.m. I've been up since 5:15 a.m. I'm pretty tired right now. So I'm going to stop and put away some things. I'll save this car for maybe tomorrow. I'm just going to go inside. I say inside. I've mentioned it before. My man cave. My slash man cave slash studio. It's separate from my house. So I'm going to go in and sit down on the couch and Bella, the large Maine Coon cat, will leap up there into my lap and make a little nest. And we'll watch a little TV. And that'll be my day. So anyway, I'm just kind of rambling. Take care. Thanks for watching.